Welcome, everyone. This is Danny and Carl with Get Wisdom, and today Carl is going to channel Timothy McVeigh. This is part of our channeling series. It's been going on for, gosh, I think 4 years now, and we've had a lot of channeling subjects, and this one promises to be interesting, like so many of them have been. This is relatively recent. I mean, maybe not for some people now, but it was like in the mid-90s when this happened. Timothy McVeigh was convicted for the Oklahoma City bombing and put to death for it. So that's our topic for today. So thanks, everybody, for joining us. And thank you, Carl. And we will have a little discussion about this, and then Carl will channel Timothy McVeigh.
Okay. Well, thanks. Welcome, all of you who are watching. We appreciate it. We're here for you. We're wanting to add some additional light in the doings of human culture and experience with a larger agenda of helping to heal the cause of the problems that are plaguing us and dragging us down as a society. And this is going on worldwide. Americans aren't used to thinking of themselves as being in a troubled nation, but people are working hard to create that sort of environment, stirring the pot all the time. So when acts of terror happen, regardless of the purported instigators, it makes sense to take a look at what's going on and see, is there more to the story? Is there a pattern? Is there a tendency of things to be changing for the worse, and why? You know, there's common sense in that. rather than be complacent. And I think we're too complacent often as a people, and just sort of accept things as they are told to us. We think the watchdogs and the government has everything in hand. And oftentimes they're not our best friend and not truly informed even about the truth of what is reality. But they're just sort of passing along talking points given to them by their minders. And so it's quite a confusing state of affairs.
Yeah. Definitely.
Well, and going to the light to talk to people who were here and had a part in history can be very, very informative. And that's why we do it, to get their perspective now. Because being back in heaven, they're going to have an unbiased view of things. And right. We've had former perpetrators come clean and talk very openly and candidly at what they were a part of and why. And it's to help us now. And it's just like anyone who does wrong and sees the light. You know, where does that come from? Well, that's what we're talking about. You know,
right.
Going back to heaven, seeing the light and being back in alignment. And we all have our innings. We all make mistakes, and we live in various states of confusion and ignorance and don't know any better.
Yeah.
But when we get back and get attached to that history and see the details like we never can as a physical human, you know, we really see how this fits in with an ongoing campaign of, you know, kind of a degradation of society.
Yeah. So my my research was mostly based on the reading of this book here. It's called Aberration in the Heartland of the Real, The Secret Lives of Timothy McVeigh by Wendy S. Painting, PhD. It's a Trinday publication, Chris Milligan. I have a lot of respect for. He's published quite a few amazing books. He's up in Oregon and been around for a while and done a lot of books like this. So the thing is, you know, like in mainstream media and a lot of the books, he's portrayed as a lone wolf. And that's one of the theories. Lone wolf theory is that he was, you know, the main player. There was a couple other guys that were involved. They got arrested. That served time. That were like accomplices. But basically, they portrayed him as the mastermind and the lone person responsible for this. The evidence pointed elsewhere. And there was one policeman in Oklahoma City who knew better. He was there. He was on scene. His name is Terrence Yeeke, and he was killed. They called it, I think it was ruled a suicide, but his body was, you know, drugged from a car out into a field, gunshot wounds, all kinds. I mean, the forensic evidence was very clear that it was not a suicide. His name is Terrence Yeeke, a black fellow in Oklahoma City, big guy, really well respected in the community. I don't know of any other book on Timothy McVeigh that has this much research. This is a 600-page some odd book. I think the last 100 some odd pages are just in the notes section right here. And I also have to give kudos to this book. Just the section on mind control alone is worth the price of admission on this book, in my view. I've read a lot of reading on mind control, and she did an excellent job at looking at that whole subject. A nice overview, and as it pertains to McVeigh's situation. So there's these groups of theories, about McVeigh and the bombing, one of them being the lone wolf theory, and the other one being like a patsy, kind of like a Lee Harvey Oswald type character, et cetera. I think I'm going to beg for indulgence here, and I just read this first part of the there's a little bio that we do at the beginning of these that kind of sets the stage, but it's only like a minute or 2 minutes, got a little background music, and it scrolls through. And if someone's listening on the audio, they don't hear it. It's just something you read if you watch the video. So I'm going to read this preface here because it kind of sets the stage for where my questions came from for this. So this is the preface. This is her writing. There's also the acknowledgement section and a publisher's comments at the beginning of the book. So this will kind of set the stage for us, give us some information, and then we'll get into a little bit more discussion about what Carl's actually doing with the channeling, and then we'll start the channeling itself. So on April 19th, 1995, at 9:02 a.m., a truck bomb exploded in front of the Murrah-built federal building in downtown Oklahoma City, killing 168 people. Sometimes you see the number is 167. There was a leg that was found, and a lot of work done on that and redacted, and the FBI was heavily involved. And apparently, if my memory serves, they never found out who this leg belonged to. But there was a leg out there that was unaccounted for. So that's the difference between, I think, 167 and 168. It's whether you count the leg or not, including 19 children. 2 days later, authorities named 27-year-old Timothy McVeigh as the prime suspect in the most deadly attack on American soil. Thereafter, his visage quickly dubbed the face of terror, inundated the media, this thus becoming seared into the archives of public memory. In the immediate hours, weeks, and months after the explosion, a number of rapidly formed and highly conflicting narratives about the bomb, both the bombing and the bomber, appeared and spread. The stories have developed over time and continue to circulate today. Their construction involves a complex and dynamic process of collaboration, competition between multiple individuals and institutions with various motives, agendas, and intents, stated or implied, all of whom assert different facts based on different evaluative criteria. Authors of the stories include journalists, victims, and survivors, eyewitnesses, the FBI, federal prosecutors, politicians, experts, analysts, pundits, defense attorneys, and notably McVeigh himself, which is a big part of the story because after his incarceration, he was, a lot of the information that he promulgated was allowed to go out into the world, and it created a lot of different stories. Within each narrative, the material facts and chronology of events, as well as the roles of and identities of the villains, differ, as do the acts attributed to them and their purported motives. Today, Timothy McVeigh, an American terrorist, all-American monster, and for a time, the most hated man in America, continues to personify a wide range of prototypical Cold War and post-Cold War identities: a self-styled Rambo, survivalist, militia type, gun nut, lone nut, disgruntled soldier, rogue avenger, boy next door gone bad, and quintessential conspiracy theorist turned rabid, homegrown, lone wolf, domestic terrorist. In McVeigh's face of terror is all reflected in the ghost of Lee Harvey Oswald. And like Harvey Oswald, John Wilkes Booth, Sirhan Sirhan, and a number of American lone gunmen before and after McVeigh, all of whom inspired multiple competing, highly conflicting, and continually evolving narratives and debates about just how alone these lone wolves really were. Many of the narratives that appeared after McVeigh's arrest claimed to tell the real and sometimes suppressed story of the 1995 Oklahoma City bombing. All of these stories were and continue to be told publicly by diverse groups and subcultures within multiple genres, fictional, historical, biographical, academic, and journalistic, and are transmitted through many media, printed, digital, televised, and cinematic. Various readers and commentators have labeled these narratives alternatively as fantastical, fictional, or accurate historical accounts, the stuff of conspiracy theories. So that gives you, I'm not going to read the whole thing, but that gives you a little background of like where we're coming from at this thing. It's kind of becoming a part of the cultural fabric, especially in the whole conspiracy thing here, because it kind of cemented a lot of ideas about what a large portion of Americans now kind of formulating their relationship with their own government. You know, Waco was a big factor for him. For Timothy McVeigh himself said that Waco, the events at Waco, formed a lot of his thinking about what happened to him, his role as a serviceman and stuff. So he was embarrassed about that, to be a soldier and to be, an American and have his own government do something like that in Waco, Texas. So that's another event that figures largely in this whole story. When I think of him, I think of people like Jeffrey Dahmer and the monster of the Andes, Pedro Lopez, and really dark figures, and the surprises that we got from them. And this whole idea about, like, if you want fewer victims, he'll the perpetrators, you know? And we think of him as a perpetrator, but after reading this book, I see him as a victim.
Yes, well, I think there's a story there for each and every person we have been conditioned to hate and hold up as the poster child of evil, and whatever the flavor might be of the moment in their leanings, their affiliations, their social media posts, and all of that that we tend to label people with, and often run away with the narrative a bit in exaggerating it. Mm-hmm. There's a lot of people who are not quite cautious, maybe the word, in becoming associated with the unsavory, and they might do it for any number of reasons, and it can get them into real trouble in hindsight.
Yeah.
And it's not always the full story.
Right.
And many times people who have a legitimate reason to be nosing around in dark corners, maybe they're working for the government, cultivate a persona like that purposefully so they can get in the door and be accepted amongst certain people in an organization or an underground movement or something. And of course, that makes them an easy scapegoat then. If something happens, something goes wrong and it blows up and they need to blame someone. So it's not the government who failed to stop it. It's just the lone nut. That's all that was involved. And it's very convenient.
Right.
But it speaks to the issue of really trying to understand evil in all of its workings and the various ways that it shows up. It certainly causes tremendous harm. And this certainly was as horrific as almost any other event in the modern era. You know, you can start looking at numbers as differentiating, you know, well, 9/11 is worse than the Oklahoma City bombing and so on. But in terms of heinous consequences and rationale to begin with, you know, considering the details you alluded to, there was a daycare center with little children in the building.
Right.
And they all perished. You know, this is just horrific. So something involving a preponderance of evil needs to be explored. And that leads to insight and can lead to enlightenment, which we mean as healing through the application of divine love and wisdom. That's how healing happens.
Right. And that's how enlightenment happens. It's an outgrowth of healing.
Yeah. That's right. And enlightenment, we've been taught by Creator, is a healing journey, a healing need getting reckoned with.
Right.
Something taking you away from the light. You know, it might not be like a wound on your body, but a disparagement, a discouragement, a distortion of thinking.
Right.
And that is an impediment to being in divine alignment. And so to be enlightened means to get back into divine alignment with the light. And literally, enlightenment really means what it says, because that is the ultimate answer. You can't be in alignment and then be walking in a life of lies. The two don't match.
So, Carl, one of the things I know we've discussed before in the channeling sessions about channeling and everything is the limitations. So this is a, you know, there was a lot of cover-up going on with this thing. The FBI was notorious for withholding information from the defense. There's a lot of unanswered questions, things that should have been pursued that weren't pursued. A lot of people that were involved with this are still alive. We're going to ask a question. I'm going to have a question here about Louis Jolion West, who was worked with the CIA with the mind control, and a question about Andreas Strassmayr, who was a supposedly an intelligence figure from Germany who kind of was on the scene and disappeared. He's in his early 60s, apparently still alive. So what's the deal here? What are we going to be? We're not going to get detailed answers about some of this stuff. Some of these questions are probably going to get sidestepped. Why is that? Why, and is it really Timothy McVeigh that you're going to be talking to in terms of his human experience or his perspective as a light being? I want you to talk about that a little bit, because this is potentially going to be a channeling that's going to get maybe a few more views just because it's Timothy McVeigh, and there's a whole lot of unanswered questions that are it's kind of like the Kennedy assassination, but it's more recent, and there's a lot of living people involved in this one where we don't have that anymore with the Kennedy assassination.
Yes, and that poses extra difficulties for us in looking into the details to any extent, because the light will not cause harm to people. And they know us and our tendency to rush to judgment, to want retribution, to want accountability, and often through legal means, and if not that, a kind of social tarring and feathering by dragging out the dirt and trying to get even. And it might be well-meaning in a sense of wanting that episode to be rebalanced in some way, but it's not really our job necessarily to apply a punishment to anyone.
Yeah.
And that's usually where it's all headed, you know, one way or another. You might be the investigator, but really, the use of that investigative unearthings will be used to render judgment and then a form of punishment, if nothing else, ostracism and slanderous criticism that will tar someone's reputation, make them anathema in the public arena or whatever, or potentially, you know, not a given, but so. The divine wants nothing really to do with any of that, because, you know, you think
and by extension, Timothy himself wants nothing to do with that.
Right.
Right. Because that's who we're talking to.
And he will not tell us something that will cause harm to another person, even if it's someone who got him killed.
Yeah.
Karmically, if you do something to harm one who harms you, you're just joining them in the perpetuation of a criminal undertaking.
Right.
And, you know, two wrongs don't make a right. It's really that simple, at least in terms of how karma works. The law of cause and effect is what we call karma for short. It's the kind of return of bad and good back around to us, and the expectation is, all right, here's your mess. Now what are you going to do about it? Are you going to make it better now? Are you going to give some sort of rebalancing and make restitution, compensate your victim, give something up? So you are living a karmic consequence, a lesson, you know, that kind of thing. So they don't want to create new karma, and they will not embroil us in a way that could get us involved in a legal ass. At least I hope not.
Yeah.
They certainly will never intentionally do something like that. And we might stumble into something ourselves by overreaching. And we have to be a little mindful of that also, you know, considering this is something we cannot prove, you know, that I'm talking to Creator or to Timothy McVeigh in person.
That's another good point. They're not going to reveal something that, this can parallel the idea of keeping us safe. It's like some new revelation that says, oh my gosh, this is something that wasn't known. But you know what I mean? It's like, but say somebody in the FBI knows it's true, and there's Carl channeling Timothy McVeigh, and we have this new piece of information or something gets validated. It's tracked back, and they go, oh, okay, this is somebody we need to keep an eye on, because he's got inside information. We don't know how he's got it, how he got that information. Yeah. But all of a sudden, you're on the bullseye. So, I mean, that's the thing the divine realm is going to try to help us avoid.
Yeah, and so this comes up with a fair amount of regularity. If we channel a former whistleblower, Right. In a sense, we're taking on that role and we're helping them being to be an extended whistleblower in an unusual way, but it puts us in the line of fire. And I can tell you, I personally don't need that. I have a lot of reasons that the darkness doesn't like me and what I do. I don't want to add to it unnecessarily. And the other thing about the divine is they have rules they have to follow about not being leading, not jumping out ahead of us to reveal things we have no idea of. And that is taking the lead. And even God won't do that because this is the land of free will, free agency. We're supposed to run it. We're supposed to figure things out. We can get divine assistance, but it will always be indirect for that reason. God can't even prove its existence. If you hadn't noticed, you know, where's the where's the big reveal? You know, God comes out from the curtain and says, oh, I'm really here, guys. The joke's on you. Well, God won't do that because we're working through that dilemma of having to live with uncertainty and have faith in spite of it. That's a big challenge for many. Often people drift away and become secular and a hardcore atheist and so on. And it's in their worst interest to do that. And they're in peril and don't know it. But it has to be allowed under the rules of engagement. So we're not going to get huge revelations here, I don't expect. But maybe some corroboration that some of the diligence of the researchers that are on record, where there is some track record of investigative knowledge that's solid, they can speak to because it already is on record, done okay. by humans.
Okay, so I got one other little quandary here that I want you to discuss, and then we should get started because we've already burned up 20 some odd minutes. My first question is, some say your death was faked, and if not, was your transition successful? So it's possible that his death was faked and he's still alive. So in this scenario, what can we expect?
I don't have a clue.
Okay, but we do have instances where a person has reincarnated or could be alive. I know of one case in, yeah. specifically is alive, and we still get to talk to their higher self in the yeah. light.
Yeah, so let me address that because okay. that can indeed happen. And sometimes, yes, they have reincarnated, even though they did pass away. But the reality is, if someone's not available as their human soul extension we know of is, in this case, Timothy McVeigh, his soul is still available and can be queried and will know everything that part of him knows. Okay. So we've had this circumstance before, and we talk to the soul level on behalf of people who are in the living.
Yeah.
And it works just fine because what we want is that divine level perspective about the person and their doings and the person's life. And right. in actuality, pretty much anyone in the light could do that because they are privy to extensive right. knowledge and can find it instantly. If they all want, and
all right, so, you know, so I'm gonna talk about a hypothetical situation here. So my question: some say your death is fake. If not, was your transition successful? The answer could be, we cannot answer whether our death was faked or not, but we're willing to continue with the questions, and we'll do the best we can. And what I'm alluding to is here is that if he says, oh yeah, my death was faked, and that's true, well, that's that we just painted a bullseye on Get Wisdom.
Yeah.
Right? So that's a plausible scenario, is that the question won't be answered, because in order to answer it truthfully, you know what I mean? So he's not going to go one way or the other. He's just going to say, you know, however you will say it, he'll sidestep the question, and he won't talk about transition. You know, he'll answer some other part of the question or whatever, right? I mean, that's a plausible scenario given what we know so far.
Yeah, and wouldn't surprise me if there is more to the story. And that might be the best they can do is sidestep and then just leave us wondering, or maybe it's unconfirmed, but maybe the door is open, whatever. But then that's us drawing our own conclusions. But there's nothing then substantive coming from them to confirm or deny it. And so that's another way of, you know, leaving it back on our shoulders to deal with or not, or speculate or not.
He's probably not going to tell us if his death was faked or not. I mean, he might say, you know, my death was not faked. I did die. And then that, you know, then that's not, that's obvious. But he's not going to say, yeah, my death was faked and I had plastic surgery and I, you know, I'm speaking Spanish in Bolivia now, you know, whatever. Probably not going to say, we're not going to get an answer like that. Probably not.
Probably not.
Yeah.
But the fact we're talking, but I, what I would do in throwing a bone to the researchers, the speculators, the people fascinated with the story and who are inclined to believe that aspect, I would say, don't let the fact we claim to be talking to Timothy McVeigh constitute evidence that he's either dead or alive, because we can go around him in effect and talk to the soul level of Timothy McVeigh.
Right. Okay.
And and still get solid information that's relevant to our questions.
I wanted to bring this up because it could get quite confusing, you know, when you start looking at all these channelings and, you know.
I'm already confused.
So. Well.
You know, no pressure. You know, I you know, that.
And I have an interest in it because of the old story going way back to the second channeling we ever did together was with the, was the Secret Service agent, which was me, right?
Yes.
So I mean that was a weird you know, that was a kind of a you know, Denny when he was naive, but we learned a lot from that whole episode, that exchange. Well, I'll speak for myself. I did. I learned a lot from that. And
And it's consistent totally with all the things we've been saying.
Right.
That there's always workarounds and there's always reasons for doing that. And there are many times we've done things and asked things and gotten what we thought at first were unusual answers. But then learned enough later and going back and sort of probing further, there was a good reason for the way it unfolded.
Yeah.
And we at first might have begun to doubt the process and the validity, but on further explanation, we're informed about why things happened the way they did, that there was a reason for it. That did make sense in the end, and righted the uncertainty, so that we could feel more comfortable that we're doing something that's legitimate.
Yeah, we're barking up the right tree here.
Yeah. Right. And I cannot prove anything, and that's because the divine won't.
Yeah.
You know, go that extra distance. So the best I can say is, I've asked over 5,000 questions of Creator, you know, separate from these other beings we talk to. That's as improbable as anything else, I think, in the average person's mind, that I can summon God and have a conversation and record the exchange. And having asked over 5,000 questions, I've learned many, many things I had no idea existed or how they worked. And I was trying to find out. And I did find out. I had to do a lot of preparation and scholarship to lead me close to the truth. But then I would get a revelation to take me that extra step. But I had to prepare myself. But I can tell you, in retrospect, there's no way that could have happened just coming from within me. Because these are things I was totally puzzled about.
Right.
And I've learned about phenomena I didn't know existed at all and found sometimes wildly improbable still to me. But it was because it was such a perfect answer to a question I was keenly interested in that they revealed to me this unusual phenomenon. Okay, so there it is. Now, it's outside me. Is it God? I can't prove that to you either. But it sure is lofty. It sure is consistent. It sure is loving and of great benefit to all that we're doing in trying to do some humanitarian work here. That's our focus. Saving
and healing. That's the focus. And I have to say that, like, since my first interaction with you, I've never seen a situation where the work you were doing was in service to something other than healing, ultimately. We have a lot of these forays into with this channeling series and stuff, but that we're doing that to attract people to get wisdom so we can promote the solution to the problem. Like, we're, you know, we beat the problem over the head, because that's a big part of the problem. It's because people mostly don't understand what the problem is. So, that's right. You know, one thing leads to another. So this is our best attempt, is to, like, you know, draw people in, get them interested in the solution, which is the healing, which is, you know, the channeling is secondary to the healing. So, and that I've never seen an exception to that. So,
And I think here's an example. We're going to talk to a presumed criminal about a dastardly deed and the circumstances around that and what his life was about and so on. And I'll bet you dollars to donuts, he's going to end up talking about how to heal the world.
Yeah.
Okay. So, because this is what the light cares about. And it is why we're here as human beings. And we hear it all the time for good reason, because I think it's true. It fits all the data.
Right.
We're not in a nice place. Things don't go smoothly.
Right.
And people are getting worse as human beings by ordinary criteria.
Right.
And saying and doing things that just are not normal.
Yeah.
Inexplicable.
Right.
And it's routine. So we know there's a deep reason. So I think we'll get an earful about it from our subject today.
Okay. All right. Let's go ahead and get started. We've got 7 questions for him, and it's likely to be a long channeling, so let's go ahead and get started.
All right. I will do my thing to reach out to him in the light through Creator. That's how I do my channeling, to make it accurate, authoritative, and safe. Most channelers are being duped. I say this really pretty much every interview we do, just to have it on record and to caution people to be skeptical of channeling. It is elusive. It's a subtle kind of interplay of energy, and it's easily co-opted when people expect to reach something lofty and they don't ask in a prayerful fashion for divine protection. They're going to end up talking to an extraterrestrial psychic, because they're watching the skies for people like that. And they'll go and say hello and form a partnership, and then it goes from there. And so most channelers are not channeling who they think they are. They get a lot of happy talk, a lot of plausible spiritual discussion that is reassuring and uplifting and intriguing, but it doesn't ever provide solutions to problems that aren't just sort of a vague handing it back to the person, you know, kind of reassuring them they're a light being, they have the power to do this, and your mind is powerful, and you're a creative being, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, well, that's fine. But right now we're a physical diminishment of our light being selves. So we need something more. And what is that? And you won't get an answer. It'll just be, well, it's up to you, and hold the right vibration and focus on the positive, not the negative. You know, I kind of call it dime store religious notions that they're kind of like a starting point just to get in the right mindset. But they won't bring you actual solutions. They won't fix you. They won't fix others. So I will go ahead and start making my connection. And that's the backdrop here as best we can.
Okay. Thank you.
This is Timothy McVeigh speaking.
Thank you for joining us. Some say your death was faked, and if not, was your transition successful? Can you tell us about what really happened in your last days and why your execution came so quickly when compared to other death row inmates?
Your channel is wrestling with our revelation at the moment, not liking the answer that will be forthcoming. But as he is now resigned to his fate, we will, I think, proceed with the intentions we have for your questions to give honest answers in earnest, in the interest of the so-called big picture, as is in the vernacular, which grossly understates the importance of what is going on in the world and the fact that this exchange can make a material difference in saving you from a dark fate. So let us get on with this. The unpleasant part your channel is recoiling from is not the idea that we might have escaped the hangman, so to speak, the executioner, and lived on, and perhaps unleash a witch hunt of some sort, but something more bizarre. The reality is, I was replaced by a reptilian imposter in the course of taking an interest in the dark doings of nefarious groups operating at the time and kind of gaming and role-playing, guerrilla kind of activities in wanting to be a patriot at heart, but really responding to an inner corruption that is likely to be operating in all such individuals and all such groups who flirt with violence or any kind of criminality to carry forth their objectives. As such, I myself was killed, but long before I was arrested for the Oklahoma City bombing and sentenced to death, I was replaced by a reptilian shapeshifter to carry out my persona and continue working with surreptitious organizations to gin up trouble. Not because this is the highest and most important devious undertaking of interest to the extraterrestrial alliance, of which that race of beings is a member, but because this was more a kind of a lark for that restless being who, as typical of the reptilians as a whole, are quite savage. They have a bloodlust in their thinking, and chafe under having to behave themselves in polite company, so to speak. So even as an imposter taking the role of human and have agreed to do so, it is unpleasant duty in many respects. Even if they are the president of a nation like the United States of America and thus at the pinnacle of power from human perspectives, there will still be many constraints, many mundane duties where they must smile and pat people on the head and kiss babies and so on, the traditional politicking expected of a chief executive who, after all, is there because of popularity to a significant extent. So this reptilian was looking for an opportunity to have a mission on the front lines in the contest between good and evil, where he could be out and about and engaged hands-on with the implementation of dark planning. They do not think of it as evil. They think of it as an example of their cunning and intelligence and their craftiness to pass among you as human, stir up trouble of all kinds, and get away with it. Because even if caught, the blame falls on the human persona, not on them personally. And there will always be an out, a sudden, unexplained natural death, a suicide, or in this case, a speeded up execution. What happened was that reptilian left the body behind, but moved into another dimension, reappearing as its physical identity and its own self, almost instantly, unscathed and untroubled, and feeling proud of himself for all he had been a part of. So that bombing created quite a stir and was a horrific example of alien mischief. They are the true perpetrators here. But keep in mind, they do their evil through human hands or human collaborators, making it possible. And it is all an orchestration and a manipulation to bring it about. So we will be getting into that in more detail. I was left in limbo after my passing because of the horrific experience of having been taken over and had my mind essentially commandeered and wrested from me in a kind of violent torrent. And it was quite shocking to be the victim essentially of murder, but with that extra savagery, much like one who is captured and then tortured before being killed by a depraved serial killer. We apologize for the goriness of these descriptions, but this gives you just some idea of who you're dealing with. When you think of extraterrestrials who are in physical form, remember this story. The reptilians might be the most bloodthirsty, but all are depraved. All are functional psychopaths of the first order. They are loveless, heartless beings. Even as they smile and render platitudes and serve up warmed over spiritual principles, things that are lofty in tone, promises to make your heart leap, It is all a sham. They are outwitting you and laughing at you within. So that is the story of my true passing. And I was rescued through the grace of you and your practitioners doing spirit rescues for all in this series, and those working to support Get Wisdom with their use of the Lightworker Healing Protocol, which reaches out to address at least the plight of all lost soul spirits everywhere. That is one of the most beautiful of gifts, because it is a plight no one deserves and none will enjoy.
Okay, thank you. So I'm going to continue with the questions as written, and I just ask that you would make a distinction between the reptilian and you yourself, as it may apply for clarity's sake, and we'll just go from there. Sometimes it's not going to be needed, but if you could make the distinction, because we don't know when you were killed. Okay, second question. Did you act alone in the Oklahoma City bombing as commonly believed? If not, what is the most accurate and detailed explanation you can give us regarding this event without endangering us or harming others?
This indeed is a delicate matter because it involves aspects of the law enforcement system at multiple levels of government because of the high crime here and the involvement of the entire U.S. intelligence and law enforcement apparatus in one way or another. And even the White House was involved in expressing concern and having discussions about the investigation and so on. We are not here to point more fingers of wrongdoing at others, but we can tell you with authority that this bombing was a conspiracy involving multiple perpetrators, including those on the scene on the day of the crime, as well as supporting organizations they were complicit with to give them inspiration, practical assistance in formulating a coherent plan, and impulsing them with mind control manipulation for them to take part without hesitation, with a high degree of conviction that was essentially a kind of compulsion they could not resist if they chose to. This is a hidden aspect of what happens with many who are involved in the so-called terrorist attacks. They may well have a track record of fundamentalist beliefs tinged with savage precepts and ideology, judgmental, seeking revenge, retribution, perhaps claiming to be acting on the part of the divine as their rationale, as with a jihad. But we can tell you all such individuals are being minded, by which we mean programmed, to take their ideology and push it to the hilt with an exaggerated sense of personal importance, and that taking action on those beliefs is a personal imperative they must see to at all costs. And that includes throwing their own lives away in many circumstances. Many, many people have causes but many fewer choose to die for those causes. It is mostly lip service when safely at arm's length from a contest or a state of confrontation that could be risky personally. This is not to denigrate anyone, simply to differentiate the degree of inner corruption and turmoil that can be induced in a person without their realization it is coming from something external. Their perception is they are taking an ever keener interest in doing something, and the idea comes to them of how to act on this impulse, and it becomes irresistible. And a focus with all of their awareness, and they will not let go until that deed is done. Subsequently, they may hold on to that inner conviction because it is imparted to them as a set of inner beliefs. It becomes who they are in a functional sense, as though their genes were rewired. And now they are a savage beast and no longer a human being. At least to some extent, they have become a different person. They may not speak openly about these changes and confess it, or at the opposite extreme, may extol the wonders of their achievements. Or they may be somewhere in the middle where they admit to the deed, assuming they have survived their participation in the first place, but in fact be somewhat puzzled about why they feel the way they do, because a part of them now is able to access prior ways of thinking, and they see the contrast. They may even lack much conscious perception of all they took part in, depending on what levels of the mind were accessed and manipulated the most heavily to get them to contribute their efforts for something ghastly to happen. So those members who participated in the crime did so as human beings, with the exception of my reptilian replacement, but out of an inner conviction in the cause they were representing, put there as an inner corruption by extraterrestrial psychics programming them within their minds, aided and abetted by dark spirit attachments within them to work relentlessly to promote the idea of revenge, to show the flaws in the established order, to make a splash while doing it in a way that would get national and even worldwide attention. This shows two things. First of all, it shows the ability of mind control manipulation to make a group of people collaborate in perpetuating the crime of a century at the risk of their own executions for no really significant personal gain whatsoever. This is not normal. To get a group of people engaged in high level abnormality does not happen by chance. It is orchestrated to happen each and every time you see it. Keep this in mind as a working principle for exploring, investigating, and understanding tragic events of this sort. The idea of a lone nut is a myth that is heavily cultivated within your culture and through the media and through the brainwashing of the psychiatrists, the psychological professionals and community of therapists who study the mind. They are conditioned through mind control manipulation as well to look at the most profound aberration and simply dismiss it as a derangement that is inexplicable and beyond human understanding. Case closed, another lone nut. We can tell you with authority, there is no such thing. People do not engage in acts of depravity on their own. There are always influencers inspiring and guiding them. You are in the midst of a contrast between good and evil. Those who are good citizens, who have a humanitarian level of interest in others, wanting to see the world become a better and better place, love and care about their children and grandchildren and their future, and want the world to become ever better, are being influenced as well, but by the divine. All others are being more influenced by the darkness because it has the upper hand. Not because the divine plays favorites or is shirking its duty, or lacks the power and amount of love needed to reach everyone. It is the respect the divine has for the individual to make their own choices. And many have chosen to move away from the idea of the spiritual, the reality of the divine. It's not real to them, and they have turned their back. This is allowed, even though it can be devastating in the long term for all making such a choice. So that is what took place with this crime. There were individuals of a criminal bent who were being cultivated to serve rogue ideas and organizations, but not realizing fully themselves what this would lead to, because it became an exercise in manipulation beyond their ability to even resist, let alone understand fully the implications that would result. It is a kind of ultimate example of the phrase, be careful what you wish for, And even those seeing it, but having been close to the fires that put it into motion, ultimately gave pause in recognition of the severity and had some inner human qualms about what was unleashed, that it might have gotten out of hand and gone over the top, so to speak. That is because we're talking of human beings here. Even though people living on the fringe, more susceptible to unconventional ideas, often harboring resentment of the established order and convention because they found themselves on the outside, at least in their own thoughts, not appreciating their own hand in choosing a path that would guarantee that happens, but still human and having a link to some awareness that love exists. We can tell you that love is God on the move. Wherever that love originates and is expressed or even just felt within, without the person taking any action whatsoever, it is God showing up. That is why even the atheist can be altruistic at times in the perspective and be a genuinely nice fellow, quite happy, a friend to all. They simply do not realize that the God force, the love force, they are names for the same thing, still moves through them by virtue of divine love and support of their existence. So this was a gigantic departure from divine alignment that was orchestrated and manipulated to happen. But it was planned by the extraterrestrial alliance to be larger than life and to make a huge splash as a kind of shock to the system, and to undermine faith in the government, to raise many nagging questions about all sorts of things. This creates a discord and a ripple of discontent, and is done again and again and again through all such acts of evil, big and small. Wherever you see a criminal harming a victim, it is the darkness at work, and likely the same body of dark spirits have corrupted that perpetrator to inspire or at least diminish their own faculties to see right and wrong in the moment and only want some selfish impulse to be rewarded through the harming of another. This is a vast conspiracy of the darkness that brought about this travesty that hurt so many and still lives as an example of evil perpetrated by those who take matters into their own hands and have a grudge against the established order That was the purpose. To create an iconic event. To forever label those against the government as a potential danger. It is now in the back of the minds of all who see the recent presidential election protest resulting in the trespassing by a mob of the U.S. Capitol and labeling that as an insurrection. Evil takes hold where love is withdrawn. And we will have more to say that about that as well.
Okay, thank you. What was your relationship with Elohim City and Andreas Strassmeyer? And what was their part or his part in the event that took the lives of 167 people?